I hope you had a chance to mark your Bibles so you could follow along as I read this morning's scripture. Again, we're reading from the book of James, chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. My dear brothers and sisters, how could you claim to have faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ if you favor some people over others? For example, suppose someone comes into your meeting dressed in fancy clothes and expensive jewelry, and another comes in who is poor and dressed in dirty clothes. If you give special attention and a good seat to the rich person, but you say to the poor one, "You can stand over there, or else sit on the floor." Well, doesn't this discrimination show that your judgments are guided by evil motives? Listen to me, dear brothers and sisters. Hasn't God chosen the poor in this world to be rich in faith? Aren't they the ones who will inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? But you dishonor the poor. Isn't it the rich who oppress you and drag you into court? Aren't they the ones who slander Jesus Christ, whose noble name you bear? Yes, indeed, it is good when you obey the royal law as found in the scriptures. Love your neighbor as yourself. But if you favor some people over others, you are committing a sin. You are guilty of breaking the law. For the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. For the same God who said, "You must not commit adultery," also said, "You must not murder." So if you murder someone but do not commit adultery, you have still broken the law. So whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. There will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you. This is the holy word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church. I just want to say a happy Thanksgiving to all, as Thanksgiving will be coming up on this Thursday. I hope that in the midst of this craziness that is brought on by COVID-19 and the steps that we're being asked to take, that you will find ways to still express thanks to God for all that God is doing in your life, and that you will find safe ways to celebrate with family, be that virtual or however. You will notice that I'm back to recording in the living room at the parsonage because I found that I was exposed to COVID-19 on the 8th of November as I helped preside at a church conference. And my doctor feels confident that it was not close enough contact to have allowed me to pick up the infection, the virus, but he's asked me to remain quarantined for another 5 days. So we are here at the parsonage recording. Just a reminder, we thought that we had taken all the precautions necessary, and I think we did, but it doesn't mean that we can't be exposed and put at risk even when we do. So keep that in mind. This morning we're wrapping up our 3-week series on systemic racism that I've titled, "This Is Our Story." And if you've been with us all along, you know that so far we've looked at our story as it's been fleshed out by the behavior of those who preceded us in our Methodist denomination. We've looked at the struggle of racism within the formation of this new Christian denomination in the new land of America centuries ago that formed the Methodist Church. We've talked about times when some in that church rose to the occasion and pushed for the abolishment of slavery and the compassionate treatment of black individuals of that time. But we also had to confess that there were times when their voice and actions were buried by the common sentiment of the day. And that was so often the case that deep divisions happened that literally took decades to begin to repair. We also spent some time looking at how our story was colored by the action of white American Christians that went before us, often laying the foundation for complacency and even complicity as racial injustice swept across our land. We learned as white Christians in America that it was easier to accept whatever was, and rarely did we see white Christians in America leading the fight against racism. Our history tells the story of white Christians in America supporting racial reforms predominantly once the dust had settled, the reforms had already been put in place, and had been generally accepted in society. Regardless of what denomination we may lay claim to, regardless of what country we live in, if we identify ourselves as followers of the God of the Bible, we should find racism to be as offensive to us as it is to God. We should be offended. We ought to be heartbroken, appalled, grieved, outraged, and disgusted by the racist events that are taking place all across our nation. And I'm not talking just about the racial injustices that have dominated so much of our news this year. Nor am I talking about systemic racism alone, because the reality is that before systemic racism can have any possibility of happening, there has to be a fostering of racist beliefs within the land. I'm talking about the kind of racist beliefs that many of us Christians would like to think don't exist anymore. The kind of racist beliefs that we thought were left behind during the struggle for civil rights from the 1940s through the 1960s. The kind of racial beliefs that led to the bombing of that 16th Street Baptist Church that we talked about last week. The kind of racist beliefs that we can't believe could exist and survive into the 21st century. But folks, survive they have. And those racist beliefs, just 5 short years ago, inspired a young white man to enter the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina, where he shot and killed 9 black members of that church during their Bible study. How can this happen? In America, in the 21st century, in a church, inspired by the kind of racist beliefs we'd like to think don't exist anymore. But the evidence is clear, they do exist. My whole life I've been told that racism is wrong, that prejudice, discrimination, or antagonism directed towards someone of a different race and exercising power over them based on the belief that one's own race is superior, that's sinful. I heard that from my parents. I heard it from my school. I heard it from my church. I heard it from my college. I heard it from my seminary. And I believe that the vast majority of Americans know that racism is wrong. It's one of the few things that almost everyone agrees on. And yet, I wonder if we've spent much time considering why it's wrong beyond the fact that we've been told that it is. Oh, we can easily make our "I hate racism" opinions known, but maybe we're just looking for some moral high ground or for pats on the back or a way to prove that we're not like those people. Or maybe we're just saying what we've always heard everyone else say. If we are followers of the God of the Bible, that is not enough. It can't be enough. As Christians, we need to think and feel deeply, not just the what of the Bible, but the why. If racism is so bad, why is it so bad? And I want to be right up front with you this morning. You won't find the words racist or racism in the Bible. Those terms didn't come into being until much later in human history. But trust me, the Bible has plenty to say about those ways of thinking and being that become the foundation for racist behavior. This morning, you're going to see me open my Bible and read passages, and I'll refer to other passages because this morning isn't about what I think. It's about what God reveals to us in the Scripture about how we are to view one another and treat one another. So let's see what the Bible says about why racism is so bad, why it is so offensive to God. Let's start with the very first verse of our text for today. It comes from James chapter 2, verse 1. Listen to what James writes. My dear brothers and sisters, how can you claim to have faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ if you favor some people over others? Now, I want you to hear what he writes just a few verses later in verses 9 and 10. But if you favor some people over others, you are committing a sin. You are guilty of breaking the law. For the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. Boy, did you hear that? Partiality is a sin. When we treat people unfairly, when we assume the worst about persons and peoples, when we favor one group over another, we don't reflect the God of justice, nor do we honor the Christ who came to save us all. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27 says that we're all made in the image of God. Most Christians know this and believe it, but the implications are more staggering than we might realize. As a white man, I am no more like God in my being, no more capable of worship, no more made with a divine purpose, no more possessing of worth and deserving of dignity than any other human of any other gender, color, or ethnicity. We are more alike than we are different. Paul reminds us in his letter to the believers in Rome that everyone made in the image of God has also had that image tainted and marred by original sin. All are sinners and fall short of the glory of God, he tells us. So we may have been made in the same image, but we've all got the same problem. We're all sinners corrupted by the fall in the garden. Folks, we are so much more alike than we are different. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, Paul reiterates the fact that if we're believers in Jesus, we're one in Christ. Throughout the New Testament, we find that justification by faith does not eradicate our gender, our vocation, or our ethnicity. But it does declare that our first and most important identity is not male or female, not American or Mexican, not black or white, not Spanish speaker or French speaker, not rich or poor, not influential or obscure. Our first identity is as Christian. All of this is to say that we are more alike than we are different. In Genesis chapter 11, we see God using language as a curse to separate the various peoples and to block them from creating a monument to themselves that Tower of Babel, which would cause them to drift away from God. So language literally became the curse of Babel. And it was a separating, dividing curse. But in Acts chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, language became the gift of Pentecost that brings the various peoples together. It was the telling of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ in all of the languages represented by the people present that drew those people together, that they all might hear about God's love for them. In Matthew chapter 22, verses 39 through 40, Jesus lifts up the command to love our neighbor as we love ourselves, because real love as we hope to be love, is what it's all about. No one can honestly say that racism treats our neighbor as we would like to be treated. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, John wrote about how God really sees our hatred of others. I want you to hear what he writes. These are strong words that come from the Apostle John. Again, it's John chapter 3 and verse 15. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. And you know that murderers don't have eternal life within them. Unfortunately, we can hate without realizing we hate. The ugly truth is that hatred doesn't always manifest itself as out of control rage, and it doesn't always turn into physical murder, thank God. But hatred is murder of the heart, because hatred looks at someone else or some other group and thinks, I wish you weren't around. You're what's wrong with this world, and this world would be a better place without people like you. That's hate, which sounds an awful lot like murder and sounds exactly like racism. To hate is to reject God, because Scripture defines God as love, perfect love, the love that Paul describes in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. I know this is a familiar passage of Scripture, but I want you to hear it again in the context of this message this morning. We're going to pick it up in the middle of what he writes, where he says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Did you hear that? Paul described God's kind of love as love that rejoices in what is true and looks for what is best. There certainly is no room for racism in that kind of love. You can't always trust and always hope when you assume the worst about people and live your life fueled by prejudice, misguided convictions, and plain old animosity. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, Paul made it clear that Christ came to tear down the walls of hostility between people. And I just want to say, this isn't some Pollyanna promise about everyone setting doctrine aside and getting along for Jesus' sake. What Paul wrote about in chapters 2 and 3 of Ephesians is about something much deeper, something much more glorious and much more important. If we, who've been made in the same image, born into the world with the same sin problem, find the same redemption through the same faith in the same Lord, how can we not draw near to each other as members of the same family? When I search the Scriptures, it becomes pretty evident to me that antagonism toward people of another color, language, or ethnic background is antagonism toward God himself. It's lashing out at God's design for eternity. As Christians, we ought to reject racism and do what we can to expose it and bring the gospel to bear upon it. Not because we love pats on the back for our moral outrage, but because we love God and we submit ourselves to the authority of his word. In the coming year, we're going to be looking for some ways to effectively take a stand against racism. There will be opportunities to lend our voice to the outcry and conversation to end racism. But we'll also look for ways to put action to our words, ways to not just communicate, but to demonstrate that we believe that we are all part of the family of God and should be treated as such. We're going to be looking for ways to live out the gospel, the good news of God's love, especially toward those who are the recipients of racism and racist practices. Here's another piece of good news, though. You don't have to wait. You can do this within the circle of those whom you have influence with, and you can start right now. Ask God how and where he would have you demonstrate his love to those who are experiencing oppression and injustice right now. And then, maybe the most important thing, pray for the courage and the motivation to do just that. I pray it will be so. Let's pray together. Holy God, what a revelation your word brings today of how your heart must break as you observe how your creation is treated by your creation. How we as part of your family oppress or sit by and allow injustice to take place or place blame because of the skin of someone's color or see them as suspect more than any others. Shame on us, Lord, for not loving our neighbor as we would love ourselves. Help us to own that part of racism that has found a home within us. For some of us, that will be a very small piece. Others of us might have to own a larger part. But Lord, help us to see who we really are when it comes to the issue of racism in our world. And bring your word to bear upon that which you reveal within us, that we might be transformed by your holy word, and we might become the true reflections of you that you created and called us to be, that we might be beacons of love and hope in a world filled with so much injustice. I pray it will be so, Lord. In the name of Jesus, amen. I send you out of this worship time today, your own sanctuary at home, to be the people of God in the Church of Jesus Christ you were created and called to be. Those who, like Jesus, stood up for those on the margins, stood up for those who were pushed aside and pushed down and looked down upon and treated unfairly. I send you out to be a reflection of the true God of this universe, who created you to make him known in the world. Be a light of hope wherever you go, and a voice for justice. in all you do, all you say, all you think. I pray it will be so in Jesus' name. Amen.